All right, back inside the writer's room with the guys from NHL.com. Brian, I'm starting with you this time. Taking a look at 50 through 35, and I think you guys were all in agreement. Nick Backstrom at 39, not sitting well with the .com guys. Why not?
70 points in each of the past five seasons, and then we saw what he did in the playoffs, right? 23 points for the Caps, helping them win the Cup. People are going to say Alex Ovechkin has a lot to do with this, and of course he does. Ovechkin's one of the best goal scorers of all time, but Nicklas Backstrom is a tremendous two-way player.
It's the other way around, too. Like, what is Ovi without Nick Backstrom?
Sure. I was going to say, look at the numbers when Ovi plays with Nick Backstrom and when they don't. I mean, it's starting to change as they get some new blood, but when you look at the beginning of that relationship, I mean, that's the foundation of everything that Washington's done. All the times they've come up short but have been an elite team, and then even this year, you know, he's the engine that makes everything go. You know, centers are so important, and wings aren't. I think it's a little different with the Capitals because Ovi is so important and can do so much for them, but I don't think he can do as much when Nick's not around to kind of – he pulls all the strings and he makes things happen. To me, he's like the classic midfielder in soccer. He just controls everything and how it works and makes everybody around him better.
Some of the best saucer passes we've ever seen in that game as well. What do you think, Adam?
Criminally underrated, Nick Backstrom. I think at 39, he's way too low. I think he's an elite player in the league. I mean, top 20 player in the league, I would say. Just the way, and Sean said it best, you don't notice what he does until he's not there. And he's helped Ovechkin become Ovechkin, you know, with the passing, with, you know, covering back behind him. When Ovechkin wants to jump up in the play, maybe get too far ahead, he's got Backstrom to kind of sweep behind him and help pick up anything that gets past going back the other way. Yeah, I think Backstrom at 39, you know, I would have had him. If it was my list, I would have had him higher.
Yeah, he kind of makes that power play go, too. He has him, you said, maybe top 20 for you right now?
Sure.
What about you guys? How high is Nick Backstrom on your list?
I think he's in the 20 to 25 range.
Okay.
Yeah, again, you got to figure out who you're going to move down.
Right,
but that's where I think
exactly.
He is.
Pick your poison. You move somebody up, somebody's got to go back. What about how high? How high is Nick Backstrom for you?
Top 25 for sure.
Okay.
Yeah, I think the numbers speak for itself. Like Sean was saying, him and Ovi go hand in hand. Alex Ovechkin is not the player that he is without Nicklas Backstrom and vice versa.
All right. Interesting between 50 and 35. Four goaltenders popping in there. Connor Hellebuck, the highest ranked of the goalies we just revealed, coming in at number 36. What do you feel about the goalies getting some love here in this department?
Well, it's great that they're getting some love. I think it's too low for a lot of them.
Okay.
I'm not sold on Connor yet. I mean, he had the great year last year, got Winnipeg to the conference final, kind of remade his game, remade himself. But let's not forget, at the beginning of the year, Steve Mason was brought in to challenge because they didn't know who he was going to be. I want to see what he can do this year. The guy that I don't need to see, well, there's three guys I don't need to see what they're going to do this year because we know what they're going to do. There's Marc-Andre Fleury, who's won a couple of cups, was brilliant this year in getting Vegas all the way to the Stanley Cup final. Pekka Rene, who won the Vezina and has been good for years. And then the guy that I would put first out of those four goalies is Jonathan Quick. No need to even talk about his resume. Again, a couple of cups. This year he was so good, a 921 save percentage. Brilliant in the playoffs, gave up seven goals and lost because they couldn't score against Marc-Andre Fleury.
Unbelievable.
But, you know, I think when you look at those two guys, they go hand in hand. Mark and Jonathan have kind of battled through the years and been elite goaltenders together. But if I'm putting those four goaltenders in line, Jonathan Quick's the first one. And then we can fight about Marc-Andre and Pekka. And then Connor's the last one. And I don't even know if he's in that top 40 there. Maybe I only have three goalies there.
What about Connor for you?
I like Hellebuck. And you know, I think if we're doing this list a year from now, I think Hellebuck might even be higher than 36. I think you go back 2 years ago, he looked like he was on the come. And then, or I'm sorry, 3 years ago, he looked like he was on the come. And then 2 years ago, he had a little bit of a step back. So like Sean said, they bring in Steve Mason to kind of inspire and motivate him a little bit. And not only does he answer the bell, I think he over-delivered. You know, he set the U.S.-born goalie record for wins in a season with 44. You know, for whatever value you place on wins, that's still a really big deal. He inspires confidence in that team. They are not the same team when he's not in net. He allows, you know, the Scheiflies and the Lines and the Bufflins and the Ehlers and all their elite players to go and run and score knowing that they've got an elite guy behind them. And I do think he's an elite goalie. So, you know, where he is on this list for now, I think is good. I think if we're looking, you know, looking forward, I think he's a little bit even higher as we move forward.
Brian, you like where all four of these goalies are kind of lumped in
Well,
here?
First things first, with those crazy eyes, I'm not saying anything negative about Connor Hellebuck, all right?
So oh, my God.
I'm not going there. He had a really good year. He's got a really good team in front of him. So I'm sure he's going to come close to duplicating what he did this past season for the Jets. But like Sean was saying with Jonathan Quick, the resume speaks for itself. The resume has to count here. I know it's the 50 players right now. I get it. But Jonathan Quick had a phenomenal year, like Sean said, he's a two-time Stanley Cup winner. He's back to normal as far as his health is concerned, and he can take the Kings to the next level, I think, again, this coming season.
It's funny, definition of right now keeps coming up, right?
And if it's right now, I think Quick's that guy.
Yeah.
He's that guy right now, and he's been that guy for the past, what, decade?
Yeah.
Close to a decade. Like, so there's no question about who he is. I think there's still a question about who Connor is. And I think he's going to go way up. And I think in a couple of years, you're going to be talking about Connor Hellebuyck like you talk about players like Holtby, who's kind of gone that same direction, and other guys who, you know, are elite goaltenders. But there's plenty of guys that have had one or two good years in this league, and all of a sudden you wonder where they are and what happened to them. So I just want to see a little bit more. I want to see more of the resume.
All right. Speaking of resume, Matthew Barzal cracking the top 50. Resume, he doesn't have one just yet, but, man, what we saw in that first season is pretty
incredible.
All
the trophies on his resume.
I guess, yeah.
Come on, look, 85 points as a 20-year-old kid. Now he's going to be 21 this coming season. We saw him play with Anthony Beauvillier and Jordan Eberle. Will Anders Lee play with Matt Barzal this year? And if Anders Lee becomes the 40-goal guy again, does Matthew Barzal crack 100 points? I think it's possible. This is a kid who takes the crowd out of its seat every time he's on the ice. He's an electric player.
What about you guys?
I like Barzal. Yep. Here's my only question about Barzal. How much help did he have by having John Tavares take all the hard assignments, all the number one checkers? I like Barzal. I go back to, you know, when he was playing in Seattle in the Western League, and he was a really, really good player then. And we knew he'd be a top 15 pick, and you know, we thought he'd be an elite top one, you know, number one, number two center in the NHL. That it happened as quickly as it did maybe was a little bit of a surprise. But, you know, now can he handle being the number one guy, the focus of every team that they play? Number one, he's going to see every defense pair. He's going to play against all the elite centers in the league. Can he do it? I think it's going to be very interesting to see if he can handle that sort of uptick in level of play.
We're going to find out.
And they have a book on him now.
Right. He's like, not going to surprise anybody.
He's not surprising anybody. People have spent the whole summer figuring out how to stop Matthew Barzal.
You got to catch him.
Yeah, you got to catch him, but there's other things that you can do, and people are going to deploy new ideas, new players against him. He's going to see different players, like Adam said, and he needs to overcome that. Then you get to year three, and then you say, hey, this kid's the real deal, but let's get through year two and see where he's at.
Not top 50 for you?
No.
Okay.
Top 60.
All right, close enough. Again, we'll come back in a couple of years. We'll see how the list changes. But right now, it's the top 50 right now, and that was 50 through 35.